going to be doing a in-depth sniper build for Fallout 1. I have uploaded a video before, but it was no audio, and it was only about roughly 30 seconds, so I couldn't really explain why choosing certain traits and certain you know, stats and special skills matter to the sniper build. And if you're wondering what version of Fallout I'm using Fallout Fixed, which is a restoration mod which tweaks the game a little bit. It's, I guess it would be a mod, but it just restores like a lot of content and adds a few tweaks to the game, and it overall like fixes just a lot of bugs. So right now we are going to go to create a character, and I'm going to explain the basis of creating a perfect sniper. Okay, so the first thing here to creating a sniper is that we are going to want to go to the optional traits, and you could go without them, but I highly don't recommend that, because it adds a little bit of fun to the game, a little bit of uniqueness, if that's a word, and it just alters gameplay for the type of character you are going to build through Fallout. Alright, so the first trait you're going to choose is Gifted. The reason why we're going to be using Gifted is that it gives a bonus to each one of these stats, so we can give more and take away more. And it does cut our skills in half, but that shouldn't be too much of a worry when you're going through Fallout, because they give you plenty of points and it does not take long to level up. So we're going to go to Gifted, and then the second trait we would use is Finest. See, the reason why I choose this one is because that you do more, you do less damage, which is not a good thing to most people, but you have a much high more likeliness to, you have a much higher chance, that's what I was trying to say, excuse me, you have a much higher chance to gain a critical shot, which is good. So that pretty much wraps up the optional traits, but now we can go into the special traits. So for strength, in my opinion, the only reason I would ever put a lot of points into strength in Fallout 1, or any Fallout game for that matter, is if I'm doing a unarmed or melee character, because other than that, you don't really need too much. Yeah, it lowers your hit points, your HP. It lowers it by a small amount. Instead of starting off with like 30 health, or 33 health, you start out with like 27 or something, or 29, or something around that number. You easily gain that back, and you gain that back when you level up, and you gain points when you level up, gain hit points. So your health increases every time you level up. So there's really no point in maxing it out in strength, because you see, Fallout is a very, very easy game. It's not hard at all. It's very deep and it has a lot of complex dialogue, but it's not a hard game at all. You can go from straight to the vault, from Vault 13 to the raider camp, and you can clear out everything. And usually, depending on what you choose for this character creation here, you start out with like a knife, a gun, and a flare, and a few stim packs and some ammo. So, with that, anyone could be able to clear out the whole raider camp. And the raider camp is, to newer players, I'd say much more intimidating, per se. Like a more intimidating area. It definitely was when I first started playing. But, you know, that's. But when you get into the many, many, many times you actually start playing Fallout 1 over and over and over again, it's not. It's just, a breeze. And I was able to clear the whole raider camp with very low strength. So for strength, we're gonna wanna put it at 4. And the like I said, the reason it affects the carry weight a little bit, but that's not a huge deal because most of the stuff that you find, most of the stuff that you find, you can just hoard it. Like you can have 3 strength and 3 endurance, and you can hoard all these weapons and stuff, and you still have a little bit left over. And you're also gonna be collecting like bags and backpacks and stuff, so you can have more storage. So 4 is like the most you should ever put strength, and that really goes for any character besides like a melee character or an unarmed character, but we'll get into that later when I do a more in-depth commentary on a melee and unarmed character. Now, starting off with perception. Perception is a very, 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 very good stat when it comes to long range. It affects how well you're able to hit enemies from a range and how far you're able to hit it. If you have one perception, there's like no way in hell you can hit anything that's around 20 feet in front of you. And it's a very, very important stat. And so we are going to put it at 9 because it is just such a crucial stat. You shouldn't even put it something. You shouldn't even put it below 7. Like, I would say even below 8. Like, I would say you shouldn't put it even below 8. Like, but I guess if you really want to push it 7. But if you want to guarantee to hit your enemies like every single time, then get the perception of 9 because it is enough, and stuff like that. It's enough to pretty much get anything done. Because there's no need, rather than in Fallout, there's no need to really max out your strength or your perception or your endurance or your charisma or your intelligence or your luck or your agility. Is because there is a option in the game, in the Brotherhood of Steel base, where you can increase your certain stats, and there's certain books and interactions you can have that can boost your special stats. So really maxing out something is either too much of an overkill, I would say. It is also just wasted because you could receive an upgrade to that in like the beginning of the game. Or later in the game, I mean, not the end. So I would say just do not max out anything. So the perception of 9, of having a just 9, is a good idea. Endurance. Now, unlike strength, endurance is a much more important stat, but just like strength, it's not 100% needed in the sense that it only affects your hit points and your damage resistance and radiation resistance. And as long as you have like Radex with you and Rattaway, you're not gonna have to worry about that too much. But you shouldn't need any more than 4. If you want to, you can put it at 5 just to make sure. Just in case like you're worried about dying too quickly. But starting out at 4 is enough for all your needs. Yeah, you do start out with low health, but you can easily compensate that for the critical hits you get from Finesse. And since you're gonna be building a character that's meant for long range, you're not gonna have to worry about being hit too much. Now, charisma is a horrible stat. It only affects your speech. It only affects like two other things, two other skill sets that are completely broken. It's a dumb stat, and even if you're making this charming character, you don't need charisma. It's just a dumb stat. Anyone will tell you to avoid charisma. It's a dumb stat. Avoid it. Intelligence is absolutely crucial for getting extra experience points and for unlocking dialogues and being able to do certain things like repair, first aid, and just special dialogue options that won't be available to you if you have a certain intelligence level that is under, like, as if your intelligence level is 9, you have way more available dialogue options than someone that's at 4 intelligence. And you also gain less from 4 intelligence. What's funny is that in the game that it does affect how well you word things, the intelligence stat. So you can explain something to a NPC in the game or have a dialogue option that is very complex and very wordy compared to if you have the intelligence of 4, which is basic simple common speech. So you won't have all the, you won't think of smart things to say and stuff like that. And if you have it up below 4, 3, 2, 1, you're just gonna have barely even audible things. You're just gonna be spouting out random things, like you can't even form words. So unless you're doing that to be hilarious, starting anything below like 6 is not good, or anything below 7. So intelligence, put it at 9. There should be absolutely no need to put it at 10, and there should be no reason it should be below 7. Unless you're doing certain builds, but we'll get to that later in other videos. Now, for agility, see, Fallout 1, if you don't already know this, is a turn-based combat game. So, in combat, you'll have your agility affects how many action points you have. And action points dictate how many moves you can make on your turn. And if you have really poor agility, then you can only maybe attack once, and move only a little bit, or do certain things. So see, in combat you need points to access everything. It costs like 4 action points to go into your inventory, 2 action points to reload, 3 action points to carry a unarmed attack, 4 to 5 action points when dealing with a melee attack, and then it takes 5 to 6 for your average gun. So if you start out really with anything super low, you can only have maybe 1 turn per level, or per you can only have maybe 1 move per turn. So let's just say, instead of attacking the enemy, you need to go into your inventory to get Stimpak, or Psycho, or Rad-X, or whatever. You waste 4 action points just going into the inventory to heal yourself. Then when you get out of the inventory, you don't have enough points to attack. Which will cause to have it be enemies or the opponent's turn, and they could end up doing the same amount of damage, so it's will end up being a wasted turn. So for agility, it's very crucial to have a great agility. So we're gonna put that at 10, because like I said, at the Brotherhood of Steel base, you are able to boost your agility by 1, which is good later in the game, so it would be a waste to max out at 10. Yeah, that's pretty much it. And for luck just, you know, it affects certain situations, like random encounters and stuff like that. But you should put it all the way up, just because just whatever you have left, put it in luck. See, I have 1 character point that is left. Usually this is not the case, but if I were to put it in 1, I would either put it in perception or put it in intelligence. And for this, I'm just going to put it in intelligence, because you can just keep leveling up and leveling up and leveling up, and increase, you know, your weapon skill or something like that. So that pretty much covers it for the special attributes, special stats. So now we're going to be moving on to skills, and for this one, obviously we are going to select small guns, because it is the most common form of ranged weapon we're going to deal with. It is kind of pointless to put your skills in big guns and stuff like that, because if you select big guns, and big guns are mainly like miniguns and rocket launchers and stuff like that, so putting it in big guns is kind of a waste, because you won't unlock any of that until like much, much later into the game. So if you select big guns instead of small guns, you're gonna suffer badly. So I recommend putting your tagged stat into small guns, because it gives you a boost and it will increase the skill you use with rifles and pistols. See, and for a second one, we could either put speech, just so we, you know, to get prices on things and to convince to get special dialogue options and stuff like that. So starting out as speech is also a very good stat. And there are a few other things we could do. Maybe instead of after you get further into the game, you can start investing time into your tag skill points into energy weapons, because you don't really discover energy weapons until the very end of the game, middle of the game. But it's still, I wouldn't select energy weapons like to start out with, but towards the end of the game, when you start finding energy weapons, I would recommend start putting skill points into this. So that leaves us with other putting it into. My recommended thing is rather putting it into lockpick, just to unlock things and stuff like that, or putting it into first aid. So when we get healed in combat, we can heal ourselves more efficiently. But yeah, the thing I recommend most of starting as a sniper character is lockpick, just because it gives you a boost and you can unlock stuff in the game and loot and stuff like that, and lockpick will become very important in the end of the game. So the starting skills are small guns and lockpick and speech, and that would be what I recommend your starting skills. And that's pretty much it for the ideal sniper build. But let's say you want to go without the gifted perk. First, what I would do is I would take points out of luck, and I would put them into agility, and I would put these two in for 4 strength, 4 intelligence, and we can put it our whatever other trait we want. I would recommend, if you don't want to choose gifted, I would recommend putting in one-hander, which I know that might sound confusing, but don't let the name fool you. Just because you're creating more of a sniper build doesn't mean that affects the same thing with pistols and SMGs. It will still increase your accuracy. So, yeah, and then also I would recommend the Jinx perk. Oops. I would also recommend the Jinx perk. I would recommend the Jinx perk just because you have a higher chance of critical failures and misses, and it makes the game a little bit funnier. Other than that, I don't really see any other possible options you can put for sniper. If there's anything else, you can let me know about it. But overall, this is what your setup should look like, or be similar to. So yeah, I will be posting this soon. And I'll either be going into my unarmed build, or my pacifist build, or maybe a speedrunner build. I'm not entirely sure which one I'm gonna do first, but that is it for this video. and I'll see everyone that is watching later.